Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents My Heart, Ever His, Prayers for Women, by Barbara Rainey. Narrated by Nan McNamara. Introduction. Why pray? Who hasn't felt prayer is futile? Does God hear? Does he care, we wonder? These universal questions most often arise out of our disappointments or sorrow. Personal loss of any kind reveals our fears about God and ourselves. Is God in control? Does he see me? How am I supposed to live with what's happening in my life right now? The Psalms pose similar questions. They are earthy, gritty, raw. Psalm 10, verse 1. Why, O Lord, do you stand far away? Why do you hide yourself in times of trouble? David and others wrote these prayers, laments, and songs with words that shock us in our present walking on eggshells culture. No one knows what to say or not to say for fear of offending at work, at school, with neighbors, or with strangers. Then at church, there is an atmosphere of niceness, a false, everything-is-okay exterior mask we feel compelled to wear to prove God is making good. But when we are alone, when it's just me and God, how do I talk to him? How do I not offend the creator of the universe? I feel silly sometimes talking to him, because normal, shallow, relational approaches feel ridiculous or embarrassing before the throne of God Almighty. Suffering has been a very unwelcome part of my life. Winter came again recently for me. Not like other winters, for God doesn't copy and paste, but works perfectly and individually for what I uniquely need to know and experience of him. This new season of loss took a completely different shape from previous winters of my life. A different kind of cold settled in. Not the sharp, brutal sub-zero kind, but a cloudy, damp, chills-to-the-bone cold. Like a slowly creeping fog that settles and stays, this season of loss was an ill-defined cloud, daily thickening to zero visibility, or lifting enough to see hints of sunshine through the mist. I've learned through the years that God's light shines the brightest in the darkness, so I should have remembered his faithfulness more confidently. I haven't always seen his glow in the middle of the hardest moments of my life, but over time, he has revealed hints of himself in ways he knew I'd recognize, ways that were best for me. American poet Emily Dickinson wrote, "The truth must dazzle gradually, or every man be blind." My dear Heavenly Father knows I can't see his brilliant glory in the daylight all at once, but glints of his dazzling can be seen from valleys and deep wells if I look up. If I look up, that is the key. The deeper the wells, the brighter thy stars shine. Surprising me, God inspired me to write in this season of loss, to put into words the emotions and experiences of my life as a woman as I rode those rough, relentless, pounding waves. I've never been a good journaler, always afraid someone might read my raw revelations and be shocked at my depravity. But in this season, I was fully convinced of my wickedness, and I resolved that if God sees all and loves me, what someone else might see is irrelevant. The ink began to flow. The Psalms were my daily companion every day for months. The words of groaning, complaining, anguish gave voice to my heart and became comfortably familiar to me. The descriptors of emotion felt right, not rash. These prayers of mine are not happy, life is great prayers, though like the Psalms, some are praises for what God has taught me. I've realized I am more drawn to the throne of God when life is hard. When the sun is shining and the days are easy, I just move through life enjoying the ride. The wrongness of hard times presses me to Jesus, because I know he understands better than anyone else. But I stepped into prayer, writing slowly, cautiously, and carefully. I wasn't sure I could or should be as real as the psalmist's. Adding to my fear of such blunt honesty were memories of my strong teaching to my children to not complain. We memorized as a family Philippians chapter 2, verse 14, "Do all things without grumbling or disputing." When my children complained, my comprehension of God expanded as I recognized what He endured from me, from us all, when I grumbled. I'd understood, and I didn't want to be a gripey child of God. The story of the children of Israel being condemned to wander the desert for 40 years because they complained actually frightened me at one point in my life. Paul recounts this story in his first letter to the Corinthians and ends with these words in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 10 through 11. "We must not grumble, as some of them did and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now these things happened as an example for our instruction. I had vowed not to complain, as some of the Israelites had." Then there is Job. His story also curtailed my prayers. He complained to God repeatedly, voluminously, and God rebuked him. Being a firstborn pleaser, I wanted to please God, make Him proud of me as His daughter. So my prayers for years tended toward nice, monitored, and proper. But then I saw by my repeated reading in the Psalms that all but one out of 150 end with words of praise and adoration. I recognized the key to bringing my woes to God was turning the pouring out of my heart in complaint to words of surrender and trust before closing with amen. Also startling me was the deeper discovery that God wasn't offended by my raw, honest complaints, if my heart returned to faith. God was gently inviting me to fully express myself to Him as my Father, who loved me and knew what I was feeling anyway. He wasn't afraid or offended by my emotions. So I invite you to read these cries of a woman's heart as if they are your own. Don't skip through these prayers, but listen to them carefully. Even meditate on them. Add your own words. Make these petitions your own. I hope you will see yourself in various details of my story, though you won't in all of them. Women across the globe have much in common. Many of our experiences are universal, the most important being our common need for peace in our relationships, rest in our labors of love, and forgiveness for our many heart sins. Every woman of every age needs what only God can provide. I hope my heart cries will call you to Jesus too. And remember, when you enter the valley of the shadow, it's impossible to go through life unscathed. Nor should you want to. By the hurts we accumulate, we measure both our follies and our accomplishments. My folly has been faking it before God for too much of my life. Gratefully, my accomplishment has been, by His hand of boundless grace, a rich, deep, new relationship, born out of loss, that I wouldn't trade for anything. May you write liberally to your King. Barbara, The Rock, 2019. 1. Daughters of the King. Lord, we come to You as sisters, as daughters of King Jesus. It is an honor to be named a daughter of royalty. You know each one of us intimately, but to our detriment, we know very little of You. We come before You to learn, to see more of You. Teach us, Holy Spirit. For Your gentle, patient teaching, we thank You. Lord, we know Your plans for us are all uniquely designed, one of a kind, unlike the woman next door or my friend I admire, unlike all the women who have gone before in ages past, unlike those to come in generations future. For this one-of-a-kind plan and design, we thank You. We also know You well enough to know our days are numbered. We do not know what tomorrow may bring. This knowledge is in Your safekeeping that we might trust you above our own abilities to control, as we are so prone to do. For this keeping of our days, we thank you. Gratefully, Lord, we also know some of your eternal, majestic character. You are unchanging, the same yesterday, today, and forever. You are perfect love, and in you, all fear is gone. You are our rock, the stability of our times, our peace, our comforter. For these glimpses of your majesty, this knowledge of you that centers and secures, as the ground beneath our feet seems at times to shift, we thank you. Open our eyes to see you more clearly, perhaps as never before. Open our hearts to fall in love with you in new ways, perhaps as never before. Grant us the grace to trust you implicitly and find that you are always enough. Amen. 2. Resting in your plan for me. Lord God, worker of all that is good, it is easy for me to boldly believe your good and sovereign control over all as I look at the lives of others from afar. In my friend's life, when she is struggling, suffering, wondering what you are doing in her world, I can so easily say in my heart, if not with my mouth, God knows what he's doing. He will bring good from this. I mean well. And it is true, you alone work all things together for good. Ah, but when it's my life, suddenly interrupted by a medical issue or crisis, when you bring or allow calamity that affects my world, my people, when my hopes and dreams are derailed or dashed, when my prayers are answered only with silence, then my faith feels fragile. I feel unmoored, adrift. My previous confidence in your good and sovereign control leaking rapidly like air from a punctured raft. Thank you, my Savior, that you never change, even though my life sometimes jolts and drops like a roller coaster. You are my hiding place, my constant companion, my comforter, the stability of my times, my security. Even when my life feels in turmoil from calamity, you are intimately acquainted with my every need, my every longing. You are always working in thousands of ways I cannot see and will never know. My Father, the great I am, Holy Spirit, my teacher, my guide, my helper, reveal your truth that I may be free. Turn my unbelief into belief that all my yesterdays, every new today, and each dawning tomorrow will show me you are enough for me and always will be. I love you, Jesus. Amen. Many times it has been true of me that I fall into unbelief, fear, or panic when my life circumstances change. My friend Susan Yates says, "Stability is not the norm, change is." Oh, how we want stability to be our norm. Several years ago, I discovered Isaiah chapter 33, verse 6. "And he will be the stability of your times." As if surrounded by flashing lights, these words shouted to me, "You can always have stability in life if you are looking for it in me." And that's the challenge. I look for security everywhere, but in God alone. That's my natural bent. But he wants me to look to him daily, because none of us knows what tomorrow will bring. When I start from that place, looking to Jesus for my stability and security, then I'm less shaken when the unexpected comes. 3. In need of sleep. Finally, I slide into the embrace of sheets, sigh, exhale deeply, eyelids close, day is done. Almost asleep, consciousness, floating dreams alighting, breathing, deeply. A cry, suddenly alert, eyes wide, thoughts flitting. I know baby ate enough. Is it just a dream? Will she go back to sleep? Will I? Unbidden. I remember an intended task undone, a promise unfulfilled. To-do list comes into focus in the dark. Guilt settles in. Sleep flies. My beloved's rhythmic sounds of sleep, a child's hand on my arm. Mommy, I'm afraid. Familiar regular cramping returns. Hot flashes follow, reminding me again. I am woman. Lord, you know when I sit down and when I rise up. You see me here in this bed needing sleep for the work you have given me. You know my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Lord, you are the same, yesterday, today, and forever. It is I who change. It is your constancy I need. Give me grace to adjust to these undesired regular sleep interruptions, to know your peace, because mine is insufficient. Help me surrender to these small momentary trials because you are with me, here, now. And what if a thousand...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.